SJC-12276 Commonwealth v. Shrinwan Lunn.
Swinger, good morning.
Good morning. May it please the court, Emma Winger, along with Mark Fleming and Alyssa Hackett for the appellant. All the parties and all amicus agree that in order for state officials to detain based on an immigration detainer, it must be authorized under state law. And none of the parties and no amicus point to any Massachusetts authority, statutory, common law, or otherwise, to authorize detention based on an ICE detainer. Nor could there be such authority consistent with the protections of Article 14 and the Fourth Amendment. I'd like to begin by addressing the Department of Justice suggestion that there is some inherent, unspoken authority under Massachusetts law to arrest for civil immigration purposes. I would suggest that that position is contrary to our entire arrest authority scheme, where common law authorizes arrest for crimes, and even then only under particular circumstances, and where the legislature has taken great pains to extend authority, and again, only specific circumstances, and where it has done so for civil purposes, it has included significant procedural protections.
I thought they said that consistent with the Arizona case, they can cooperate, but they certainly can't arrest state officials, can't arrest.
That's correct, Your Honor. That's our position, yes. The Arizona case.
I thought that was the DOJ's position as well.
I apologize that state can cooperate, but they can't arrest.
Right.
The position here is that a detention based on a detainer is arrest, that holding somebody for up to 48 hours after they would otherwise be released from state custody constitutes an arrest under the Morales decision in the First Circuit and generally the definition of an arrest under Massachusetts law.
Here, he was not held for 48 hours, however.
No, Mr. Lunn was not. He was held for several hours. But that in and of itself is enough for an arrest. It's certainly not an investigatory detention. He was held solely on the detainer for several hours.
An arrest happens in a civil setting like this, that it's not limited to a detainer for a criminal offense?
I apologize, Your Honor. When,
in other words, if what lies underneath the detention is a civil matter,
yes,
is that an arrest for constitutional purposes?
Yes, that is our position. That's correct and consistent with the First Circuit's decision in Morales.
Now, the Tenth Circuit in Santana Garcia speaks of police officers, local police officers, having implicit authority to investigate and make arrests for violations of federal law. I gather that may be part of what the Department of Justice is relying on. Why is there not implicit authority?
Well, there is, under Massachusetts law, we've never recognized any sort of implicit authority. And frankly,
if we were to do so, how would we do that? How does one identify or recognize authority which is implicit?
Your Honor, that's a question I don't know the answer to, and I think it raises a concern here. The idea that individual officers have implicit authority absent legislature or the courts raises a sort of concerns about arbitrary arrest that Article 14 was intended to address. It's especially of a concern here where there's no judicial oversight of the arrest itself. So there simply cannot be implicit authority. It also would suggest that the legislature's efforts over these many decades to specifically authorize arrest in certain circumstances was unnecessary. Our whole arrest authority scheme undermines the idea that there is some implicit authority.
What if, following up on that, what if ICE provides state law enforcement with sufficient information such that law enforcement can obtain probable cause?
If probable cause of a crime?
No, well, probable cause that there is a ICE detainer based on a serious felony or reentry. And then state law enforcement now has that information. They've been able to obtain it from ICE.
If it's probable cause for a civil immigration matter, then there is still no authority under Massachusetts law to engage in that arrest. It might address some of the constitutional concerns that we raise, but it certainly doesn't address the lack of authority here.
Is that partly based on the lack of a neutral magistrate function in this capacity?
Absolutely, Your Honor, yes. All
right. And can you identify other federal detainers where there are magistrate, and there is some kind of judicial or magistrate involvement?
Other federal detainers, well, if it's a criminal detainer, then it inherently comes with the protections of the criminal process. So there would be, once someone's, there would be both a right to a hearing under Gerstein within 48 hours if it's federal. So I think that this is a unique in that it is civil immigration and it doesn't come with any of those protections that come with criminal process.
And is your argument limited to a civil arrest, or would you extend it to a criminal arrest?
Meaning if there was probable cause to arrest for a...
immigration crime as opposed to a civil immigration violation, which is what we have here.
Well, I think we're somewhat moving beyond what is in front of us. I think there is certainly likely probable cause of a crime and all the attendant protections, and also common law has authorized arrests for crimes under Massachusetts law. I don't think the court needs to be concerned with that because here we have arrest for civil immigration purposes. It's a separate matter.
Now, is there any consequence? I know that you had argued that even an ICE official could not have made an arrest based on the detainer because an arrest requires reason to believe the person would flee, and there was nothing in the detainer which suggested that. Department of Justice says we're going to fix that.
Sure.
We're going to now in the future issue warrants. Does that change anything?
It doesn't change anything with respect to both the lack of state authority and the constitutional issues that we have raised here. It doesn't resolve the lack of judicial oversight. It doesn't resolve the probable cause particularity, and it doesn't extend Massachusetts arrest authority to these particular detentions.
So in terms of what you envision, if you prevail, I gather there is nothing that you say which would prevent local police or sheriff to call ICE and say this particular individual is scheduled to be released at 2:00 today. If you wish to pick him up, you may. They would be able to do that if they wished.
Your Honor, I'd hesitate to speak to the extent to which our law enforcement can cooperate with immigration authorities outside of the detainer in this case, partly because some of the constitutional concerns, the lack of judicial oversight, the degree to which we facilitate an arrest where there are other constitutional concerns, should be left, I think, for another day.
You're not suggesting that we reach that issue.
That's right, Your
Honor.
You're
simply saying that if they were to do that, and at 2:00, ICE is not there, they do not have the authority under our state law to hold them for up to 48 hours to wait for ICE to show up.
That's correct. And they also are barred by our Article 14, which requires prompt judicial review over all arrests.
You hold that position even if under federal statute, under 8 U.S.C. 1357, there's reason to believe that there might be an escape and that the federal authorities have documentation in that regard?
There does still need to be, under Article 14, there does need to be judicial oversight of any arrest, even where there's a flight.
But would that be an arrest? I guess that's what I'm asking. That's what we're trying to get our arms around, really. So the ICE has a finding that this person might be a risk of escape under 1357, and the person is released from state custody, and ICE says, well, we can be there in 20 minutes. If the sheriff or court officer holds that person for 20 minutes, is that an arrest?
It is, Your Honor. It's not it's not for investigatory purposes. It's holding somebody after they would otherwise be released where there's no basis under Massachusetts law to do so.
Now, there's no dispute under the 10th Amendment that it's a voluntary action, correct?
That's right.
And DOJ doesn't dispute that.
Correct.
Is the issue resolved going forward if the court declines the invitation to cooperate as a matter of its public policy?
If the court
if we just say as a matter of court policy, there's a voluntary procedure that you ask us to do it. We don't want to cooperate with that, and we will not. Does that resolve the issue?
If state authorities across the Commonwealth stop honoring detainers.
As there's an amicus brief that lists all the counties across the country who have done so.
Sure.
And if the trial court, as a matter of its policy, said, we decline to participate in ICE detainers, does that resolve the issue?
The concern then, though, is that at what point could that policy change? The different members of the court, it seems as though these constitutional and statutory issues need to be resolved for the sake of certainty going down the road. Otherwise, there's a risk that this unconstitutional practice could resume.
Well, what Justice Gaziano is speaking about is the exercise of our superintendent's authority, sure, which may affect what our court officers do. But I gather that what you're asking us to do is to tell police and sheriffs you have no authority under state law to hold somebody on a detainer.
Thank you. Yes, and I misunderstood. To the extent to which it would be limited only to court officers, it would not resolve the constitutional violations at issue here.
And as we pointed out, the amicus brief is filled with examples of elected officials who have decided not to cooperate, correct?
Correct. Yes, that's right.
Now, if, again, let's assume for the moment that you are right, then there would be nothing that would bar our state legislature if it chose to say we choose to give state officials this authority. That would be a legislative decision.
Your Honor, I would disagree that they are free to, they certainly could enact legislation, but that legislation would be improper because there remain the constitutional, inherent and serious constitutional violations in the process of honoring a detainer, specifically the fact that there is no judicial oversight.
So what you are saying then, as I understand it, is that if they were to do that, what you're saying, I gather, we don't need to reach that constitutional issue now because we can say that there's no legislative authority for it. If there were legislative authority, we would then have to reach the constitutional issue.
Your Honor, I would suggest that the court should reach the constitutional issue now
And what is the constitutional issue you're asking us to reach?
Well, primarily, I guess this first point, Article 14 requires that all liberty be supervised, all deprivations of liberty rest in the hands of the judiciary, and the judiciary does not have its hands on arrests under detainers. They ask for a detention for up to 48 hours with no review by a neutral, detached judicial officer either before the detainer is issued or after the detainer is issued, and that sort of power left solely in the hands of local law enforcement is contrary to Article 14.
Well, so, as the Attorney General points out, though, we don't have to reach that in this case for the matter that's right before us. And as the Attorney General's brief points out, we have a duty not to reach unnecessary constitutional issues.
We would disagree that it's unnecessary. We think that the
it's not necessary to adjudicate the matter before us. That's the term I'm using, unnecessary.
No, I understand, Your Honor. Thank you.
That's why I was trying to get an answer to that question.
I think the concern then is that it sends a message to the legislature that it could essentially fix the problem by simply passing legislation, which it cannot do. And it suggests it therefore risks wasting both legislative and then ultimately judicial resources where this matter has been fully presented to the court and briefed and argued. It's not like the cases that the Commonwealth cites where the court could construe a statute in order to avoid the constitutional problems. There is no fixing the constitutional problems here, and if the court doesn't address them now, it's likely that it will come up again.
But under your constitutional analysis, is it unconstitutional for ICE to make that arrest?
Yes.
So you'll be asking us to say that ICE may not make a civil immigration arrest because it is...
No. The court and
only state officials.
The court certainly that is not the actions of immigration law enforcement officers are not in front of this court. It is purely our law enforcement officers, and this court can decide under Article 14, as it I believe it should, that the total absence of judicial oversight of this arrest, along with the lack of arrest authority, makes this whole system both unconstitutional and illegal.
You say whole system. Are you asking us to also declare that the federal immigration procedures violate due process clause?
We do believe that this also violates the due process clause because of the lack of notice.
You want
and
us
the lack
to declare the federal immigration statutory scheme unconstitutional and violative of due process?
No, I think what we've asked this court to look at is how the process works in Massachusetts as it is effectuated by our local law enforcement. Our local law enforcement are not providing notice, and there is no judicial oversight, and there's no meaningful opportunity to be heard on the detainer. And the court can limit its ruling to, and probably it's required to limit its ruling to, local law enforcement who are the parties of this case.
Is that your position because you believe that the Declaration of Rights provides enhanced constitutional protection for the cognate provisions, or because you think it best that we not reach the federal constitutional issue?
The court is certainly free to reach the Fourth Amendment because we also believe that this violates the Fourth Amendment, absolutely, that the requirement of judicial oversight under Gerstein applies to these sorts of cases. In fact, the Immigration Nationality Service recognized that way back in 1994 when it said it clearly applied. It was clearly bound by Gerstein.
But going back to Justice Gaziano's question, yeah. You're asking us to reach that issue?
We are, Your Honor, but it is not necessary to reach that issue.
Counsel, one more question. What would the mechanism or the remedy be if this court issued such a decision or order, but some law enforcement officers decided they weren't going to comply with it? How would that be remedied, or how would anyone know about that?
Was not going to comply with this court's order?
Mm-hmm. If it's somebody who is, say, for example, in a house of correction, mm-hmm. who's supposed to be released, has no more state process pending, and for whatever reason, the local law enforcement agency in the house of correction decides that they, in fact, will cooperate with ICE. How does that then get remedied?
That sounds like a matter of contempt of this court's decision.
And how would that come to the court's attention? How would that?
I mean,
how would the court
I guess
know?
We would have to rely on the truthfulness of our law enforcement agencies and their generally desire to abide by this court's decision. I'm not sure what else at this point, but I could certainly think of other options.
So you're not asking us to stop ICE from doing anything as long as state law is complied with, the procedural protections that are required under state law, so we don't risk entangling ourselves into federal law on this question to do what you're asking us to do. Is that right?
That's right. The ICE is not a party to this case, and we're asking this court to issue a ruling as it covers our law enforcement officers.
What if state law enforcement was cooperating with ICE the way that state law enforcement sometimes cooperates with DEA?
So joint investigations. You know, again, I think those are very different from the what's before us. They involve investigations for crimes, joint investigation of crimes. And I don't think this court needs to deal with that in this particular case.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Press, welcome. Proceed.
Thank you. May it please the court, Joshua Press here on behalf of the United States. Your Honors, we're here this morning based on a case where it seems like no one actually wants to talk about the appellant, Mr. Lunn. Mr. Lunn came here in 1985 as a refugee and obtained lawful permanent resident status in the early 90s. Unfortunately, however, he has acquired quite a bit of a criminal record since the early 2000s. And on that basis was ordered deported 9 years ago, lost his lawful permanent resident status, and was ordered deported to Cambodia. Now, based on certain Supreme Court case law and federal statutes, his detention was limited because Cambodia would not accept him back into their country. And since that time, he has been ordered on supervised release, as it were. Unfortunately, however, that matter of grace to release him. While on that release, he has chosen to apparently commit further crimes and was again arrested late last year. Now, when that happens,
commit further crimes. He was found not guilty.
Oh yes, I'm actually referring to other crimes in California after his previously. Nevertheless, when that happened, I don't think he was found not guilty. I think the Commonwealth chose not to prosecute in this particular instance.
But he was not found guilty. There was not a criminal conviction in Massachusetts on which he was being held.
Right. There's just no prosecution further.
Well, I have this opportunity. Let me ask you, in your brief, you refer to him repeatedly as a criminal alien, and yet this is an arrest on the basis of a civil immigration offense.
Yes.
So he's not, in that sense, it's not a criminal immigration offense.
No, he's a criminal alien based on his prior convictions
and
order of removal.
That's why you that way, not by virtue of the offense itself.
But the instant criminal offense that he was picked on and the civil offense of violating his...
It's the civil immigration offense that is the subject of this ICE detainer, is it not?
Yes. Nevertheless, he's still a criminal alien based on his prior convictions.
Is criminal alien something that's defined in the federal statutes?
No. No, it's simply the reason why he was ordered removed 9 years ago.
So what does it mean to be a criminal alien?
Well, essentially an alien who has committed an aggravated felony and on that basis ordered, removed, or deported, as it were.
But you're not suggesting, I don't think, perhaps you are, that the authority of a state law enforcement officer to detain somebody depends upon the reason for the detainer. That if this person were being deported and had an order of deportation for reasons unrelated to any prior conviction, you're not suggesting that that changes the authority of the state law enforcement officer to hold that person pursuant to the detainer, are you?
No. Of course, the detainers have specific identified reasons to hold.
But it's not limited to those who have been convicted of crimes.
No.
So let me ask you, if there is a detainer for an individual, and let's assume the sheriff calls up ICE and says, this individual for whom I have a detainer is to be released at 2 p.m. today, mm-hmm. And at 2 p.m. there is nobody from ICE who is there. And if that sheriff, pursuant to the detainer, holds that person for 48 hours, what is that? What do you call that thing which holds him in custody for up to 48 hours after he otherwise would be released?
Well, that's, in our view, a matter of comedy and respecting the federal authority to process that alien depending on the bases for why the detainer was issued.
Constitutionally, you refer to it simply as a matter of comedy, that we're going to cooperate with the state by holding somebody for up to 48 hours? You don't characterize it in any constitutional sense as a seizure?
Well, it is a seizure, and it is an arrest.
So it is an arrest.
Yes.
All right. And do you agree that there needs to be state law which authorizes a state law enforcement official to make that arrest?
Yes. Now, that will vary from state to state, obviously. Certain states are much more aggressive in limiting the police power, and specifically the power of their police and officers to make arrests.
So why isn't our state law the answer to the question? They don't have the authority to do it. End of story.
Well, we believe this is a matter of first impression for this court. And from our perspective, all states have inherent authority to, from our view, police their sovereignty. And Mr. Lunn is someone who has no right to be within the United States, much less the Commonwealth. And he's only here, or he was only at large, as it were, as a matter of grace from the federal government.
Well, let me take the focus off Mr. Lunn, because when we took this case, we have the right, even though it's moot as to Mr. Lunn, we have the right to look at the whole picture.
Sure.
And if this issue is capable of repetition and escaping review, we're entitled to look at that.
Sure.
And to consider the whole picture. So whether Mr. Lunn is a criminal alien, as you call it, or whatever it is, that's kind of beside the point. The real issue is, what can the feds demand of the state given the state of our law?
Okay. Well, I want to be very crystal clear here. There are no federal demands being made through this procedure. This is a request, as a matter of comedy, from one law enforcement agency to another to hold, well, number one, to provide notice of the release of that alien, or number two, to hold him up to 48 hours to effectuate the detention and eventual removal of that alien from the United States. Now, there are, and there will be, of course, from state to state, different restrictions placed on state officers. I understand in the Commonwealth, for example, 48 hours is too long. 24 hours is the rule, and we have no quarrel with that. That's why, in this case, Mr. Lunn was picked up within hours of the Commonwealth declining to prosecute.
You know, I'm as I understand what your argument, you're saying that every state may
yes.
do this. The federal government cannot require it, but every state may, and that every state has the authority to do it, depending upon the state.
Yes.
The question then for us is, what in our state law does permit this? And I don't see anything in your brief that suggests what that might be.
Well, we are not experts in Massachusetts law, and therefore we did not want to comment specifically on that. I will say that the Department of Justice's position on this is that inherent within the sovereignty and...
We can, but we don't. I mean, I know that you're saying we can do it, or every state can do it. We may have the authority to do this, but the question is, do we have the authority under our own state law to do it? Not,
right.
not could the legislature do this, but has it?
Well, I guess the question I would have back to that is, has it done what exactly? Now, from my understanding of the Constitution of the Commonwealth, it was written by John Adams, essentially, in
before the
1780s.
Federal,
in the 1780s.
Yes, before the federal Constitution.
Yes, and President Adams, a very good draftsman, of course, did.
That's why we named the
like
build.
Him,
we, that's
him.
Why we named. The, that's why we named the building after him.
Right. No. We of course respect him and his work.
I'm glad you recognize that.
Yes.
Yeah.
But my understanding, more specifically, of the Commonwealth's Constitution is that in the late 18th century, the Commonwealth did enact statutes barring certain aliens from the Commonwealth based on that Constitution, and so that would seem to indicate that they had exercised their inherent authority derived from the sovereignty that President Adams had written into the Commonwealth's Constitution for such purposes. Now, Arizona v. Gant and other case law has probably modified that a bit.
I wanted to ask you about the Arizona case, because what you said in response to a few questions is that we have the inherent authority to police our sovereignty, and you conceded that the hold is an arrest.
Yes.
The Arizona case talks about federal preemption and that states can't arrest aliens. So how are those two thoughts consistent?
Right. States cannot on their own enact policies to go beyond federal law. In Arizona, SB 1070 was an extremely aggressive and essentially licensed state officials on their own without federal request for assistance or any sort of direction or supervision by ICE, for example, to make arrests and to detain on their own and then make their own investigation into that suspect's citizenship status. That was well beyond what the federal government had chosen to pursue, and that was why the federal government brought that case.
But isn't that your position, that inherent authority position? So if we say that there's inherent authority, our state police officers that are in the back can go out under their inherent authority and enforce the immigration laws.
Not beyond the federal government's direction or request for assistance, which is what we have in this case, which is the policy, as we understand it, that's being challenged. The detainers themselves are requests by ICE to local officials to hold an alien based on biometric information that the state has uploaded to the FBI, and we have sent back to the state officials, as in this case, Mr. Lunn has a final order of removal. We know this because the fingerprints that were obtained and then sent to the FBI and then sent to the Department of Homeland Security confirmed this is the person that you have in your custody. We have identified him as Shrenuan Lunn. Our records indicate that he was ordered removed from this country 9 years ago. By the way, he was out on supervised release. He has not checked in. It appears that he might be up to no good. He has now become a priority again for deportation from this country. And that's all that really happened in this case. And that's really what we're talking about with the revised forms that DHS has now put out.
But just going back to what you're looking for our Commonwealth to do, it sounds like you're saying that we don't need any special legislation to hold a criminal alien. We can just do it. Is that correct?
Well, I would hesitate to say, to make the sort of conclusion of criminal alien just based on, as in this case, there was no conviction.
Well, anybody that you're looking to have ICE detain,
right,
or an ICE detainer on, we
right
can just hold them because we've got that authority, we've got that power.
You have the power, and as we understand it, no law has circumscribed the state or the Commonwealth's power to cooperate with the federal government in these matters. Without having any sort of identified limit, then if the Commonwealth or its officers, or in this case, the Boston Municipal Court, wants to cooperate with the federal government, we don't see any particular reason why that could not happen in this case.
This inherent authority, are you saying that the state inherently has the ability to pass legislation authorizing it? Or are you saying that there is constitutional authority in the absence of any legislative act that would permit this type of arrest?
Well, what we're saying is that there's a certain room for play in the joints here, and if the Commonwealth wants to pursue...
What does that mean?
Well, good question.
If the Commonwealth, I don't think John Adams used that term in our Constitution.
There are a lot of terms he never used. But if the Commonwealth wants to pursue specific legislation, that's one route to go. In this case, I believe the Boston Municipal Court ordered his brief detention until ICE could pick him up. I assume based on its own inherent authority.
There may be some confusion as to exactly what he did, as to whether he meant he was going to decline to act, and that was interpreted as having ordered it. But that essentially is neither here nor there. But let's go back to my question as to what is this thing you say is inherent authority, and I'm trying to understand whether you're saying that the state has the inherent authority to enact legislation authorizing state law enforcement officers to make these arrests, or whether you're saying that there is inherent authority somewhere, perhaps in our Constitution, perhaps elsewhere, that says that these officers have that authority in the absence of any legislative action.
Well, they have that authority, as we understand it, in the absence of any specific legislative authorization, simply based on their being a coordinate law enforcement agency and their willingness to work with the federal government to effectuate the removal.
Isn't that an arrest so that constitutional guarantees would apply to? If the judge in the BMC said, we're done with you, we have nothing else but this ICE detainer, so you can't go until the 48 hours are up. Now, wouldn't constitutional protections attach to that?
Yes, both federal and Commonwealth constitutional protections. Yeah.
So how is it that we can just hold that person without a magistrate, without probable cause, without any of that?
Well, that's a good question with respect to the Fourth Amendment. In the immigration context, I want to be very clear here that the Supreme Court, no court has ever required a neutral and detached magistrate to make immigration decisions, to hold an alien or to issue an immigration administrative warrant.
Okay, that's immigration officials, not state officials, right?
Right. State officials can choose to cooperate.
We're talking about state officials here.
Right, and I'm talking about if state officials choose to cooperate with the federal government based on their requests, they have that authority, and we haven't seen anything specifically taking that authority away from them, from our perspective. And this is not just a matter isolated to the Commonwealth. This is for all of the states.
You could solve this problem by obtaining arrest warrants from a magistrate, correct?
Well, not from magistrates. It would depend on what you mean by magistrates. In the immigration context...
I understand your argument, but as we talked about in the last argument or the last lawyer, there are lots of states, and this, you saw the laundry list of them, that say we're not going to do this absent a warrant. And it's now it's incumbent upon Department of Homeland Security to seek criminal warrants when they want, when they really want people. Correct? Is that what is happening around the country?
There is no mechanism for criminal warrants, as it were, issued by either a magistrate judge or a district court judge or anything like that. These have always been, I mean, for decades, administrative warrants issued by supervisors at ICE and before that, supervisors in the INS.
So I guess the question I'm asking you is, what's happening in all these other states that have already said we're not going to cooperate?
What is happening?
Yeah.
The federal government is currently working with them to try to facilitate better cooperation. I know that Secretary Kelly is currently meeting with, recently has met with multiple city and local officials on this issue to try to encourage better cooperation with the local enforcement agencies.
Let's go back to inherent authority.
Sure.
I'm trying to understand its limits. It's limited to immigration. It's not with regard to criminal matters.
No, I mean, local agencies can also cooperate.
So if an FBI agent calls up somebody and says, I know you're about to release John Smith. I think he committed a bank robbery. I don't have a warrant. I don't have a criminal complaint, but I want you to hold him for 2 days until I can get there. There is authority to do that because of comity?
Well, in this case, we have an order of removal. The more appropriate analog would be an order of conviction and judgment and an order directing, a request asking that the FBI can pick him up to bring him into federal custody to effectuate that judgment.
Well, certainly if you had a court order, you could, pursuant to the interstate agreement on detainers, you could do it, but you don't have any judicial officer involved in this. You have an ICE officer who is certifying this, not even certifying it, just declaring it's not under oath.
Well, we did have an immigration judge in 2008 ordered him removed, and he never chose to appeal that decision.
All right. So now let's just know at the end of the 48 hours, you say maybe 24 hours, ICE doesn't show up. Mm-hmm. The authority ends?
Yes.
And that person who was arrested then becomes unarrested?
Yes.
Any documentation to reflect the fact that he had been arrested and unarrested?
No. From our perspective, if he reoffends and this sort of process comes all up all over again and ICE chooses to pick him up, that would be one thing. Or ICE could make an arrest in the field if they still have probable cause to believe that that person is a removable alien. There are a whole host of factors that could come into that decision-making process.
Under our state law, is there any other context that would permit a state law enforcement officer to arrest somebody and then unarrest him 48 hours and there being no record of that arrest and that unarrest?
Well, from my limited understanding of Massachusetts case law, brief arrests do occur, and perhaps they don't get processed. Those individuals don't get booked, but people are arrested
for 24 to 48 hours.
Well, 48 hours obviously would be problematic.
But that's what the detainer asked for.
That is what the detainer asked for as a maximum, as a ceiling. Yes, does not ask for anything more than that. That's to comply with the constitutional boundaries, the federal constitutional boundaries.
And just to be clear, with regard to a sheriff who has a detainer and says, I would prefer not to make that telephone call to ICE at 2 p.m., I simply don't wish to do that. There is nothing unlawful about that sheriff choosing not to honor that detainer.
There's nothing constitutionally offensive. I do want to emphasize
that. The question was whether it's unlawful for that sheriff to not honor that detainer, which you characterize as a voluntary request.
No, the sheriff would not be violating any criminal or civil immigration laws in that respect. There would, of course, be friction if this were done as a matter of policy. That's what we're trying to prevent. That's why Secretary Kelly, for example, is going around the country trying to encourage more local enforcement agencies to work with the Department of Homeland Security in these matters.
Okay, but I'm not speaking about friction or comity. I'm asking whether it's unlawful, and I gather the answer is no. It's not unlawful to do that.
No, that would present a different Tenth Amendment concerns than really what our issue here.
Meaning that if it were not voluntary, there would be a Tenth Amendment concern for essentially the commandeering of state law enforcement officers to make arrests at the request of a federal officer.
Yes, yes. Nevertheless, the issue of cooperation is an important one, both to the Commonwealth and to the United States. It's not uncommon for DHS to hold aliens and then for the Commonwealth to ask that ICE facilitate their return to Commonwealth custody temporarily, for example, to testify in a criminal trial or things of that nature.
There's process that accompanies that, though, right? There's a subpoena, there's legal process.
Yes, and that's what we're trying to do now with the new I-Form 247A, to have administrative warrants accompany the detainer requests themselves to provide assurance to local enforcement agencies such that that adequate process or that adequate levels of process are being gone through to assure the local enforcement agencies.
Who issues those administrative warrants specifically?
ICE supervisors.
They're not judicial officers.
Well, they're not judicial magistrates, if that's what you're asking. And that sort of goes to the decades of case law on a specific issue.
But they're not. They are ICE officials. They're not judicial. They're not magistrates. They're not in the court system.
Right. One other important wrinkle to that, I also want to note, immigration judges themselves work for the Department of Justice. They are executive officials.
Not Article 3 judges. They're not Article 3 judges.
Correct. Neither are, in fact, most magistrate judges within the federal court system.
Nevertheless, we do want to continue to have a cooperative relationship with the Commonwealth. That's extremely important to the United States, and that's why we've chosen to come here today. And thank you for the honor.
Before you go, let me just make sure I understand your position. Let us imagine that you prevail here today, and let us imagine that we say that there is inherent authority for a sheriff or law enforcement officer to hold somebody for up to 24 or 48 hours. And let's imagine the state legislature were to say, no, we expressly do not give that authority. We basically say they have no such authority. Are you in the same position? Is the inherent authority such that it cannot be overridden by a state legislature?
That would present different preemption issues, more akin to the Arizona case. Of course, in the Arizona case, the problem was over-aggressive enforcement.
This is a state legislature which is saying we don't want law enforcement officers to at all be involved in this. How would that involve a preemption issue?
Well, that would be an affirmance by the general court to not cooperate in any manner.
Oh, no, I'm just saying not cooperate. They simply would say they do not authorize the arrest of these individuals, which is the issue before us today.
So the over-detention?
What you have conceded is effectively an arrest.
Yes.
With regard to a civil immigration matter. They would say if there was any doubt before, we make it quite clear that we do not grant state law enforcement officers that authority. They do not have the authority to make those arrests. They can continue to call up ICE and say, in my example, at 2 p.m. we're going to release him. If you wish to be here, he'll be released at that time. That's fine. But the state legislature, in my hypothetical, says we do not wish to grant state law enforcement officers that authority. Is your position the same, that the state legislature cannot do that, or is your view that it can?
Well, depending on the specifics of your hypothetical, I don't want to quarrel with it. I think that would probably be okay under the currently existing federal case law, if that were simply a prohibition on the over-detention level of cooperation.
So you're saying then that this inherent authority is essentially an implicit, that the legislature implicitly or through some other means has implicitly given that authority. that we must discern something that the legislature has done which has given them that authority?
Yes, that's why it's inherent.
When you say inherent in what? Inherent in our Constitution? Inherent in natural law? And where does the inherency come from?
It's within the Constitution itself and the concept of sovereignty that was at play in the 18th and 19th century.
Point to me where in John Adams's Constitution we should look for that.
Well, that's not there specifically from my understanding, just as it's not specifically in the federal Constitution either. The concept of sovereignty and the plenary power authority that's the basis for federal immigration authority has been read in simply as a matter of understanding of what sovereignty was derived from the people, which is in the Massachusetts Constitution and is in the United States Constitution.
All right, thank you.
No further questions. Thank you.
Ms. Barnett, good morning.
Good morning, Your Honor. Assistant Attorney General Jessica Barnett on behalf of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and the Suffolk County Sheriff. With me at council table are Assistant Attorney General Sarah Kolb and Special Assistant Attorney General Alan Forbes. I'd like to begin where we just left off, which is with Justice Gant's question about inherent authority. Inherent authority goes to what the Commonwealth of Massachusetts as a sovereign has the power to do. It does not, as Justice Lenk point out, answer the question of what they have done. So the answer in this case lies, as Justice Hines pointed out, with our state law. Our state law is the answer to the question, end of story, and our state law has, throughout the long history of this Commonwealth, limited the warrantless arrest authority of our law enforcement agents. There's only one category of offenses for which they've had broad warrantless arrest authority, and that is for felonies. For misdemeanors, the common law restricted that authority to those offenses performed in the officer's presence that include a breach of the peace and were ongoing at the time of arrest. Now, the legislature has, over the years, expanded the authority with respect to specific misdemeanors, and some of those are listed in the red brief addendum at 38. So the legislature can modify that. The legislature has also authorized arrest for some civil infractions and for some non-criminal conduct. Warrantless seizures are also authorized. But this, in the context of civil violations, this has been done specifically by statute. There is no backdrop of implicit authority on the behalf of law enforcement agents to make warrantless arrest for civil violations.
Isn't the sheriff free to adopt whatever policy the sheriff wants to adopt? So the sheriff could say, this is voluntary, it has to be voluntary under the 10th Amendment, I'm not going to hold people?
That is absolutely right. No one, including the United States, disputes that these are voluntary requests. And so an individual law enforcement agency, such as the sheriff, could have a policy simply not to hold pursuant to these detainers. What this case speaks to and what the individual law enforcement agents would not have authority to do is to, in fact, say, I am going to conduct these warrantless arrests because Massachusetts law limits their power. So within the scope of the warrantless arrest authority granted to law enforcement agencies, they are free to enact policies that might entail different levels of cooperation with ICE under different circumstances. Certainly under the scheme that we've laid out, these detainers can perform their historical function, which was as a mechanism to notify state law enforcement agencies that ICE was interested in taking custody of an individual.
But your brief does discuss the possibility that there are some dangerous people that could be involved, and there's a public safety part of it. How do you reconcile that part of your brief that says, of course, we want to protect people from dangerous people being released? How does that happen?
That happens through the same set of tools that law enforcement agents have always had. So there is investigation of criminal activity. If that led to probable cause for arrest, that person could be detained. Again, there's information sharing, notification to ICE saying this person will be released at 2:00. And if you're interested in taking custody of that person, please be here, and we will facilitate an orderly transfer of custody. What they cannot do is perform a warrantless arrest and to detain that person longer than he or she would otherwise be held in state custody.
So basically, it's a handoff, is what you're saying. So if there's somebody who has illegally reentered and they have a violent history, what you believe should happen is the Sheriff Tompkins can call ICE and say, this person's being released at 2:00, come pick them up.
That's absolutely right. And your hypothetical adds another layer to that, which is you're positing that there's illegal reentry. So if there were probable cause, again, of a felony of illegal reentry after removal, there may be probable cause for the local authorities to arrest as well. But as the amicus brief filed by Christopher Lash points out, this has historically been the role of these detainers as a notification mechanism. Nothing in the statute passed by Congress mentions any request to extend detention as a function of these detainers. And the United States Supreme Court, in talking about the detainer provisions in Arizona versus the United States, was very careful not to call them request to hold. They called them a mechanism, again, for notification. So I don't think the United States can find any support in their resort to historical practice with these detainers.
You suggest on page 44 of your brief that if the ICE agents provide enough information to state or local law enforcement that would constitute state and local law enforcement obtaining probable cause that there could be an arrest.
Yes, and again, that would require that the collective knowledge doctrine were met, and I think petitioner points out some requirements of that is that there's a joint effort underway. So if the circumstances were such that there was a joint law enforcement effort and the collective knowledge doctrine applied, then they could consider the knowledge of all the agents that were part of that cooperative effort in determining whether probable cause exists.
Could you tell us the difference between your position and that of the defendant here?
Certainly. Well, we agree as to the essential point, which is that Massachusetts law does not authorize warrantless arrest for civil immigration violations. I think we're simply differing.
And the basis for that is?
Again, the common law rule as modified by the legislature over the years has consistently cabined in the warrantless arrest authority of law enforcement agents.
So it's not constitutionally based?
No, we're talking about statutory and common law authority to arrest.
That's the Attorney General position, not to reach any of the constitutional issues.
Correct. And I think that's where we differ with the petitioner. We recognize that there are serious constitutional issues that are raised by these detainers, but consistent with this court's practice and duty not to reach those questions unnecessarily, we are suggesting that this court base its holding on the statutory authority question.
So we need not decide the due process issue that the defendant asked us to decide.
That's correct.
Well, counsel, let me ask you a question about that. In the event that a sheriff at a house of correction decided, I am going to cooperate and hold somebody for 24 or 48 hours, what mechanism would there be for any court to be involved in that instance, for any of our state courts to be involved? How would the courts know? How would his attorneys know?
So much as this petitioner has done, they could move for release in their specific criminal proceeding if they're in fact.
But if that's over?
If that's over, then it's through a petition to this court. It's through a state habeas proceeding. They would bring to the attention of the court that they are being held without legal process.
In the hands of the federal government.
Again, it would come up, you're suggesting that it would become moot too quickly to raise it. Is that the issue, Your Honor?
Yeah. Noncompliance that we could not be able to reach. That's the question I think that Justice Cipher is driving at.
I have a feeling then, Your Honor, we would be put in a position again to have the issue raised in a situation such as this, where the underlying case has been mooted, but this court would then elect to review it because it is capable of repetition and it can evade review because of the short time period.
Is it your position that if a law enforcement officer holds somebody without authority, that that's a civil rights violation?
Under Commonwealth versus LeBlanc, Your Honor, it's very closely associated with a constitutional violation. And we haven't made the argument here that is a per se violation. Certainly under the Massachusetts Civil Rights Statute, there are additional elements such as threats, intimidation, coercion. Likely that would be met with physical restraint. But
so you are asking us to focus only on a civil immigration violation. You're not inviting us to reach the issue of whether or not a criminal immigration violation would put a law enforcement officer in a different position.
That is correct, and that is because the detainer at issue in this case, and even the current one that's just now been issued, bases the request on an assertion of probable cause of removability. Now, putting aside the issue of state authority, there are additional problems with the federal government's argument that probable cause of removability is enough, and the facts of this case illustrate that. So probable cause of removability does not equate with probable cause of detainability. So for example, this petitioner was ordered removed in June of 2008. The federal government had custody of him, could not accomplish the deportation because the country of origin would not accept this individual. And then ICE released him on an order of supervision in October of 2008. On that date, these two facts were true. That person had a final order of removal in place and yet was not detainable. It would have been inappropriate on that date for a state law enforcement agency who became aware of the order of deportation to detain Mr. Lunn.
So, and that would be true under Arizona, too.
That's correct. And even though circumstances may have changed during that time, this detainer does nothing to show it.
What happens to people like Mr. Lunn who are now in detention but can't go back to their... Is he forever in some federal lockup somewhere?
He is not there forever, and that's because the United States Supreme Court addressed that in Zavidas versus Davis. In that case, the United States was arguing that it could detain individuals indefinitely, but the court rejected that argument.
So what happens as a practical matter?
What happened is exactly what happened here. After a certain period of time, ICE released him on an order of supervision.
Is that going to happen again then?
It very well might, Your Honor. There's nothing in this record to suggest that any circumstances have changed and that they will be able to accomplish this deportation now.
Going back to your earlier issue, Mr. Press says they're going to, in the future, be issuing a warrant with the detainer. Does that change your position?
That does not change our position.
So what is the relevance of the issue of the warrant to the issue of the state authorization to make an arrest?
So our issue with the authorization under state law has to do with warrantless arrest authority. We aren't at this time making an argument that if a judicially approved warrant were presented that they could not hold an individual.
Well, that's the question about whether it's an administrative warrant or a judicially approved warrant.
Correct, and that is why the administrative warrants that are being offered now to support these requests does not change our argument at all, because they do not bring us outside this warrantless arrest authority context. So, again, they are issued by ICE officers. There's no judicial supervision or detached and neutral determination of probable cause.
How do you address his argument that the neutral and detached requirement only attaches to criminal proceedings and not civil proceedings?
I just disagree, Your Honor. I think the United States is correct that the United States Supreme Court has not applied the Gerstein review by neutral magistrate to the immigration context. What they have done in United States versus Salerno, which is cited in the state brief, is they've directly compared pretrial criminal detention, which is regulatory, not punitive. They've compared that directly to pre-removal detention.
Well, what about other civil holds in Massachusetts for someone who has substance abuse issues or someone who is a deadbeat dad? And that's a civil proceeding, right?
That's correct. And in all of those cases, there's specific legislative authorization for the seizure. We do not have that with civil immigration violations. So,
you know, I have some trouble with the concept of probable cause as it relates to civil immigration proceedings in any event. I mean, how can it be probable cause? Isn't it ordinarily understood as requiring a criminal component?
Not necessarily, Your Honor. Certainly, many cases speak of it that way because it's most often talked about in the criminal context. But as we've cited some specific statutes in the brief, for example, where law enforcement exercises their community caretaking, so they may take someone into protective custody, for example, on probable cause that they're incapacitated. That is a seizure under Article 14. And so the probable cause requirement of Article 14 applies, but it's not probable cause of criminal conduct in that setting. So if I may, I would like to suggest that the court treat that with care. So to avoid sort of categorical statements like that Article 14 requires probable cause of a crime, that is not technically the case. And I think the cases cited in the brief show that.
Going back to your brief where you cite to the U.S. Code 1357, where ICE has reason to believe that somebody who's removable as an alien is a threat of an immediate escape.
Yes.
You mentioned that there could be some cooperation by state officials in that context.
There can be cooperation, Your Honor, but that could not include detention by the state law enforcement agency beyond the time that they would otherwise hold the person on state process. Because again, even with a risk of flight, you're saying this, you have probable cause of civil removability. And probable cause of civil removability is simply not a basis for a warrantless arrest under Massachusetts law.
And just to make sure I'm clear in your position, is it your view the United States says that there is inherent or implicit authority to do this? Is it your view that authority must be expressed in a statute?
Yes. And that is because of the backdrop of the common law rule as modified over these many years by the legislature. You know, for example,
right, what does that mean, the backdrop?
That means because that I'm speaking specifically for civil violations, there must be express legislative action.
And why is that?
Because we begin with the common law backdrop. So for example, for felonies, I'm not suggesting, we are arguing that state law enforcement may arrest without a warrant someone who they suspect and have probable cause to believe has committed a federal immigration felony. And there's no Massachusetts statute specifically authorizing that. But we get that authority from the entire scheme of arrest, warrantless arrest authority in Massachusetts. That is the common law backdrop. Felonies, you have warrantless arrest authority across the board. Misdemeanors, there is more narrow authority under the common law rule as modified by the legislature. And for civil infractions, there is no baseline of warrantless arrest authority. It is simply where the legislature has specifically authorized it. That's why I say, specific to that context, there must be a legislative enactment.
And then two questions. Must it be expressed because it needs to be cabined and defined? An implicit authority by its nature is neither cabined nor defined?
Again, I hesitate to say something that is general to arrest authority across the board. Speaking simply with respect to civil violations, because there has never been a backdrop of arrest authority there, there would have to be a specific authorization of it. I think with felonies, it would be the opposite.
I'm referring only to civil, I'm not referring to.
That's correct. So, yes, although they have inherent authority as a sovereign to regulate in that area, that authority has always been limited in this Commonwealth's long history and has only been provided when there are specific legislative enactments.
And in terms of the concern about reaching beyond our grasp, with regard to your assertion that there is authority under state law to make arrests on federal immigration violations, you're not asking us to reach that issue, are you?
No, you need not reach it. But in terms of providing guidance, if this court were to craft an opinion sort of to give some guidance to other law enforcement agencies, we suggest some guidance that it could give by way of explicating the felony and misdemeanor arrest rule and how that interacts.
That's why I wanted to go back to the question I asked you before. On page 44 of your brief, when you talk about the state law enforcement officials being provided information by federal officials that there's probable cause that there has been some felony committed, and state officials receive that information, it doesn't require a joint investigation for state officials to make that arrest if they obtain independent probable cause.
If they obtain independent probable cause, are you saying if the state...
I'm just going by what's right in your brief. It's not a joint investigation. If they obtain information from federal officials that constitutes probable cause that a felony has been committed from ICE officials, that there can be an arrest.
I think there would have to be a joint investigation, and I'm sorry if the brief implied otherwise. It's the same determination that law enforcement officers have to make every day.
But you're referring to a joint investigation. You're not referring to a police officer in Worcester or Springfield who decides that he or she is going to start arresting people on federal immigration violations on his or her own.
That is correct. So,
So what you're saying is if it's a joint investigation, you can. But if it's just the state being a conduit of information from the feds, you can't.
Right. And
I think that's clear in your brief. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Okay. That's exactly what I'm saying. And I think that would play out under the law that already exists under the collective knowledge doctrine,
okay,
which we haven't gone into in great detail.
Okay. That has to be independently verified.
Correct.
And as to the guidance that you're suggesting that we provide, what do you say about the amicus suggestion that we had exercise supervisory authority over court officers and others in the court system?
So that would be, again, an even narrower way of proceeding. But I think that would have the disadvantage of not providing guidance to other law enforcement agencies, such as the Suffolk County Sheriff, who's intervened in this case, and have significant concerns about being placed in an untenable position. Were they to be asked, you know, by a bail clerk at 10 o'clock at night, oh, this person's held on a detainer, you got to take him back to the House of Correction. The guidance is needed. I think it only need to go so far as Massachusetts arrest authority. We suggest that you avoid the serious constitutional questions that are raised, but to merely limit it to superintendent's authority, again, it might not provide the guidance needed.
The sheriff is elected. The sheriff can do what the sheriff wants to do as far as public policy.
But if
why do they need us to tell them what to do?
Because the sheriff may be put in the position of, for example, having to defy a court order or detain someone pursuant to a detainer. So, for example, in this case, had the individual not simply been brought back into detention by court officers, but the court had said, okay, now, Suffolk Sheriff, please take him back to the jail, that would put the sheriff in a very difficult position.
One perhaps last question, although we'll see. We've had detainers for as long as I can remember. in every administration as long as I can remember. Why is this the first case which has, to my knowledge, reached the issue of whether there's state authority to permit an arrest pursuant to a detainer?
I think that's because criminal detainer practice differs greatly from these ICE detainers that we're seeing. Criminal detainers are very often supported by a warrant or at the very least some charging document. If it's for a person already in state custody, they're covered by the interstate agreement on detainers, which has significant
But there have been ICE and before that INS detainers for many years. Why has this issue never surfaced before in this or any other court, to my knowledge?
I think it's been coming up now that you have this specific request within the detainer to hold beyond the period where the person's held in state custody.
That's been going on. I was a trial judge for 19 years, and people, and we all know this. You know, everyone in this courtroom, I think, knows this. Court officers have been holding individuals with ICE detainers, and sheriffs have for a long time. Sometimes it's 15 minutes because there's a lot of traffic. Sometimes it's 20 minutes, sometimes it's 40 minutes. It's not till the end of the day. Well, so going back to the chief's question, I think it's a good question. I mean, this has been going on sub rosa for a long, long time.
And I think that goes to the issue of the brief detentions are more likely to go unnoticed because this has evolved to where the federal government is requesting 48 hours of detention, sometimes excluding Saturdays and holidays. You have, for example, in the Morales versus Chadbourne case, a United States citizen who's being detained and held for a number of days. That's going to come to light.
What about 48 minutes at the courthouse?
Again, I don't think that this will extinguish any litigation around the edges because, of course, there are legitimate administrative reasons that someone's release could be delayed.
But that's my question. What's the Attorney General's position if ICE is on the way, it's a serious case, the traffic's bad and it takes an extra 48 minutes to get there?
So our position is this. You cannot delay someone's release from state custody solely to wait for ICE because that would constitute a new arrest. There are going to be gray areas, of course, where there's a line of folks posting bail at the jail, and they might start with one person or another. So administrative delays do happen, but they cannot be a pretext for holding someone beyond the time that they would otherwise be released from state custody.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
We'll take our morning break.
All right.